Hello, my name is Danny Nowlan and I'm the Director of ChassisSim Technologies, and welcome to this latest episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner. And today, ladies and gentlemen, I've got a real treat for you. What we're going to be talking about is evaluating dampers with ChassisSim. And what I'm going to be talking about today is that one of the great knowns about racing, whether you're at the upper level, say an F1 or LMP1, or right down to club motorsports, there's absolutely no doubt that dampers have a critical impact on your car's performance. But part of the problem with the effect of damping on car performance is, even though we know it's important, a lot of what to do about and how to select it in terms of where you go with your damping is very, very poorly understood. And there are a lot of misconceptions out there. And so what I'm going to do in this tutorial is talk about some key background points for you to get your head around, and then I'm going to show you how to apply this with ChassisSim. Because what's really interesting about the whole damping thing is that really the whole emphasis on dampers as a tuning tool is actually a very, very recent thing in motorsport. It really came to the fore sort of in the backdrop of when Active got banned in Formula One, and everyone was sort of scrambling around, or what are we going to do now? We can't directly control our attitudes. And then a lot of guys in the senior open wheeler community were looking at what the off-road boys were doing, and big hats off to the folks at Penske for recognizing this, and ultimately brought that into open wheeler racing, and then sort of the whole thing of dampers being a tuning tool sort of all went from there. However, sometimes when you're doing dampers, sometimes it's really, really tempting to try and get a damper to do a job that actually isn't its job in the first place. But anyway, we're going to talk about all the background to this, and you're going to see some rather interesting things. So let's get started. Okay, one point I want to make absolutely and utterly abundantly clear when you're dealing with dampers: the thing that dictates damper behavior is the damping rate, not the force on the displacement graph, ladies and gentlemen. If I had $5 for the amount of times that I've said, oh, we've got more damping, and someone gives you a maximum force versus displacement velocity curve, where you see the actual damping force increasing as opposed to the rate increasing, they said, you've got more damping. If I had $5 for every time I'd seen that, ladies and gentlemen, I would not be recording this tutorial today. I would be happily retired, not just as a millionaire, ladies and gentlemen, but as a billionaire, and I would be living a life of leisure. But I'm talking to you good folk. So the key thing, ladies and gentlemen, when you're understanding a damper is when you're understanding a damper is to understand the damping rate, which is the change in force on the change in velocity. What that is, ladies and gentlemen, is the slope of that graph. That slope there, ladies and gentlemen, dictates everything that goes on with your damper. And indeed, the damper force versus peak velocity curve, the actual damp, look, if you've got increased damping rate, the force follows as a consequence. But if all you've done is pretty much by adding more gas pressure or whatever you're doing is by simply lowering it up or down, you actually haven't increased the damping. All you've done is change the preload. That is a huge, huge misconception, and I cannot ram this point home enough, ladies and gentlemen. Now, in terms of quantifying this, your typical racing numbers will go anywhere between about 3,000 newtons per meter per second through to 20,000 newtons per meters per second. And to my North American colleagues, listening in on this, I just don't say that as part of my ongoing campaign to convert North America from using imperial to metric units. I do that for a very, very clear reason. It makes quantifying and non-dimensionalizing what we do with a damper so much easier when we do it in metric. But I cannot stress enough, ladies and gentlemen, this is what drives what a damper does. Okay, so to get a real feel of what to do with where we need to go with dampers, we need to apply some metrics. And here is where the quarter car model is a very, very good tool. Now, the quarter car model in and of itself won't answer everything that goes on with a damper. But what it does is it gives you some mathematical articulation to understanding what a damper is doing, so you can start. Yeah, so at least you've got something to hang your hat around. Also, too, it translates into a very simple hand calculation. So consequently, don't leave home without it. So what we've got is that in a typical quarter car, we've got the mass of the body, mass of the tire. We've got a spring rate, and we've got a damping rate, and we've got the tire spring rate. Now, the key thing to really ram home, ladies and gentlemen, is that these are all wheel rates. So vis-a-vis their motion ratio times spring times rate at the damper squared. I cannot stress that point enough. So, going through and doing some calculations, we can derive two very, very important relationships, which are these little puppies here, ladies and gentlemen, which is our natural frequency, which is the square root of KB on MB, and CB, which is your base damping rate, which is 2 times omega naught mass of the body times the damping ratio. Now, going back to this point, ladies and gentlemen, here's why I wanted to express dampers as in metric and as a rate. The reason why is it makes all this stuff become a hell of a lot easier, because when you express your spring rate in newtons per meter, masses in kilos, and your damping rate as newtons per meter per second, all of this becomes child's play. Do not even attempt this in Imperial, ladies and gentlemen. You will get lost, and I guarantee that. So I cannot stress that. Stress that point enough. I know my North American colleagues right now are going to be getting very annoyed. Well, quite frankly, I don't care. But the key thing here is, ladies and gentlemen, is this gives you, more importantly though, ladies and gentlemen, it gives you the language, the mathematical language, to start hanging your head around what a damper is doing. Okay, let's talk about the significance of damping ratio. Just remember, where the whole damping ratio comes from is comes from a second order Laplace approximation of what a car is doing. And the nice thing about that is it actually solves really, really easily into this little response thing of where we've got damping ratio and effectively what the body response is doing. So here we've got Ksi is equal to 0.7, a damping ratio of 0.7. And as you can see, the damping response is actually it's what's called critically damped. If we go psi is equal to 1, it just goes boom, it goes straight to a settling point. And if we've got psi is equal to 0.5, 0.3, 0.1, we get even more oscillating behavior. Now, here are some key takeaways, ladies and gentlemen. Damping ratio greater than 0.5 is ideal for body control. 0.3 to 0.4 is ideal for high pass filtering vis-a-vis navigating bumps, which is why you'll always see a low-speed section of the damper and a high-speed section of the damper. That is no accident. Okay, here's some rough rules of thumb to get your heads around. And I've spoken about this in another ChassisSim tutorial, but it's a very, very powerful thing to get your head around. So I'm just going to go through it again. That in the low-speed region, what you want to be doing is about anywhere between about 0.5 to 0.7. However, if you're dealing with a higher downforce car, so you translate from a mechanical car to a higher downforce car, the control of the body becomes paramount because of the aerodynamics. In a lot of cases, then you'll have to start looking at damping ratios greater than 0.7. Sometimes even in the order of 1.2 to 1.5. That's particularly, I mean, once we're talking 1.5, we're talking F1, P1, DTM territory. Okay, Ksi for the low speed rebound. Okay, once we're in rebound, we want the tire to stay in contact with the ground. So what we want is we want a little bit of a lower damping ratio for our rebound. So as a rough rule of thumb, we want to be going between about 0.3 to 0.4. However, where body control takes precedence, sometimes we'll have to be a little bit higher. So that will cover the low speed sections. In the high speed sections, mechanically, you're pretty much going to be in the order of about 0.3 to 0.4. Your higher downforce cars, depending on how bumpy the circuit is, might be a little bit higher. Now, great disclaimer here, ladies and gentlemen. These are rough rules of thumb. Do not treat this as a facsimile from God Almighty, Allah, Buddha, whatever supernatural power you pray to. In vehicle dynamics, this sort of stuff doesn't exist. So, if you want it to exist, then I'd suggest you take it up with whoever your supernatural power of choice is. But as some rough rules of thumb, these are really, really good to get you going. Okay, now when we're talking about dampers, we need to have a think about what dynamically does a car look like? And any car can be represented by this little schematic figure here. This is called the beam pogo stick approximation of the race car. And pretty much, it's a really great way of visualizing how the different forces all interact with a car. So we've got the front pitch center, the front roll center. We've got our front downforce and our rear downforce. Now, the bumps and how the car is moving around will dictate what you do with damping, and that's really, really, really important to sort of to get your head and hang it and get to get your head and hang it around. Okay, some rough rules of thumb to consider with damping. If the dampers are wildly oscillating and the driver is complaining, you increase the damping everywhere. That's a given. That is a complete and utter no-brainer. The other thing to think about is the initial shape of the dampers are going to be dictated by the frequency response, that is tuning over the bumps, which is why, ladies and gentlemen, the ChassisSim shaker rig toolbox is such a powerful, powerful tool that's been applied on so that's been applied in categories as diverse as IndyCar, V8 supercars, right for, and GT3. The reason why is it allows you to really nail down what that contact patch load variation is doing. It also allows you to have a look at what the car's doing in the frequency domain. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is pretty much going to dictate what your base damping is doing. And then what you'll do is when you hand that to a base damper, you then go through and look at and then use that as your base, and then we'll, and then you dictate, then you have a quick look at what you want the damping rates to be, and that's pretty much what you hand over to a damper builder and say, give me that, but I want that as the mid-range adjustment. Now, here are some rough rules of thumb. Turn in under, if you've got turn in unders here, you decrease the front bump, you release the rear, and you release the rear, and you release the rear rebound. Why? It pitches the car down. Have a look at back up to our beam pogo stick approximation. So, with decreasing the front bump and releasing the rear rebound, that's going to pop up, that's going to go down. That's rare. So what we'll do is we'll lower the rear roll center, raise the front rear solder, but more importantly, if you're running aero, it moves the aero balance forward. So always think of so think of that so always think of that. The other thing to bear in mind, ladies and gentlemen, if we've got turn exit understeer, increase the rear bump. Why? Going back to the picture, what it does by increasing the rear bump, it gives it something to lean onto. So it's effective, it's effectively the transient equivalent of stiffening up stiffening up the bar or stiffening up the spring. To get you're simply getting a result to do what you actually wanted to do. And of course, once you start throwing in aero, these effects become even more pronounced. Now, so how do we go about evaluating this in ChassisSim?